morning. My name is Tim Snyder. I represent the appellants, Pacific Seafood Group, in this action. I'm going to try to reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal. We're here today, and this appeal is about the interpretation and enforcement of a bargain for settlement agreement between these two parties, or groups of parties. In 2012, two groups of businessmen, fishermen on the one hand and two seafood processors on the other, settled an ongoing antitrust lawsuit after years of expensive litigation and a lengthy mediation process before then federal judge Michael Hogan. And that court approved settlement included key terms that Pacific Seafood seeks to enforce today. First, Pacific Seafood agreed that it would not renew a 10-year joint venture agreement with Ocean Gold.
Wait, is that what it was, a joint venture agreement?
Yes, Your Honor, it was a joint venture agreement.
It's referred to throughout the briefs as a marketing agreement, right?
Well, you know, the parties used marketing agreement as a shorthand for this agreement, but in our opening brief on the motion to compel arbitration issue, pages 4 through 6, we go into lots of detail on all the different tasks and the division of labor between these two companies. Judge Panner, in the first action, the Whaley case, referred to the two parties as having combined operations, and that's what they had. Each would undertake different activities, and they split profits on the back end, and I think it easily fits within the definition of what is a joint venture. So Pacific Seafood and Ocean Gold agreed that they would not renew that joint venture that's set to expire in February of 2016. But the parties contemplated and knew that Pacific Seafood and Ocean Gold might negotiate a new agreement to replace the expiring joint venture agreement. And the parties agreed that in the event of that kind of a new agreement, that the objections would be resolved in a different way, that they would not be embroiled in a multi-year antitrust action over that new agreement. And what the parties bargained for instead with then-federal judge Michael Hogan was for an alternative dispute resolution process that was detailed in paragraph 3A of that agreement. And that's what we're asking that this court do today. Enforce the parties' bargain. Enforce paragraph 3A and compel this case to arbitration before the named decision makers.
I don't think I've ever seen a case where the parties get to choose their federal judge. They may be able to choose a court as a proper venue. They may be even able to choose a law and the choice of law provisions, but to say we choose Judge Hogan, I've never seen that before. Is there some precedent for that?
Well, this is a unique agreement. I would agree with Your Honor on that. But the parties were not choosing Judge Hogan to act as judge.
And it's not. They said Judge Hogan shall determine whether the proposed new agreement is pro-competitive.
Well, that assumes that determination is a judicial determination. What we submit the parties were doing is they had a mediator who had worked out the settlement agreement, who they trusted.
Judge Hogan was moonlighting as a mediator?
Judge Hogan was acting as the settlement judge in this case.
He was the United States District Court judge.
He was. He was not the judge in this case.
Judge. They don't mediate.
Judges. Well, this judge was serving.
You're asking him to make a determination whether it's pro-competitive. That is not a judicial determination.
That's a determination of whether a new agreement in the future that the parties had not entered into yet, whether that a new agreement would be approved as between the parties' agreement.
It would be legal, right?
Well, no. The question is whether the new agreement is pro-competitive or not.
If it's pro-competitive, it doesn't violate the Antitrust Act. If it's anti-competitive, it violates the Antitrust Act.
Well, I think there's more that goes into the Antitrust Act than simply if it's pro-competitive or not pro-competitive. But what the parties were deciding here was the plaintiffs would be giving it a very powerful contract right in the future. They would not have to show antitrust injury. They would not have to bring a full-blown antitrust action in the future. That they could challenge a new agreement through this agreed-upon process.
In other words, the plaintiffs could say, even though it is not, no, the defendants could say, even though it is not pro-competitive under the rule of reason, it's legal?
Well, no. Judge Hogan or his replacement, Magistrate Judge Gelders, would determine as a contractual matter whether this agreement could be approved or not approved. Now, certainly,
approved or not approved under what criteria?
Under the agreed-upon contractual criteria.
Which is?
Whether the agreement was pro-competitive, and if so, it may be approved.
So you're singling out an element of antitrust liability or lack of liability and saying the parties agreed that this element and this element alone would determine the validity of the contract, not the whole of antitrust law.
That's correct. That's what the parties agreed. They were going to focus on one element. And they decided that they knew this was likely to happen, that there might be a new agreement to replace the expiring joint venture agreement, and the parties did not want to get embroiled in round two. And so rather than not address that issue in a court-approved settlement agreement, they decided we're going to do this differently. We're going to submit a narrow dispute. We're going to provide notice to the plaintiffs. We're going to provide an opportunity to object. We're going to submit that dispute to the named decision maker, who is not serving as a federal judge, because I agree with Your Honor that you can't pick your federal judge. But they weren't picking him to sit as a federal judge. They were picking him to decide this narrow question that the parties anticipated would come up.
Okay, so it seems like the heart of the issue is how do we interpret 3A then of the agreement? Because what its language is, that in the event Pacific Seafood and Ocean Gold enter an agreement that requires Pacific Seafood Group to act as the exclusive marketer of any seafood product produced by Ocean Gold, then they give notice and say, well, but there's no this new proposed, this agreement is not one that even mentions exclusive marketing. It's a proposed merger, right? A stock and asset acquisition.
Well, and that gets to the next question, Your Honor, which is what is the scope of the agreements the parties agreed would be submitted under this process? And the parties, you know, they could have used very narrow language and could have said exclusive marketing agreement or exclusive marketing agreement only. But what they had as the background was this joint venture agreement, of which exclusive marketing was one of many of the undertakings that the parties had agreed to do jointly. And so the parties used broad language. They said any new agreement, meaning any, regardless of its form, whether it's an acquisition agreement, whether it's another joint venture agreement, whether it's an exclusive marketing only agreement, or whether, as we pointed out, it's an output agreement, which would not mention
but
that.
But to say any agreement, is it any agreement that requires Pacific Seafood Group to act as exclusive marketer? When Pacific Seafood buys Ocean Gold and merges it, there's no ineluctable requirement that Pacific Seafood act as the exclusive marketer for Ocean Gold, is it?
Well, our argument is pretty simple and straightforward. When a company acquires another company, they acquire all aspects of that company, including its marketing
and
abilities.
They go out and get another firm, Manny Moe and Jack, to be the exclusive marketers.
That's true. And under the current exclusive marketing agreement, they were with approval from the current joint venture agreement, Pacific Seafood could agree with Ocean Gold to delegate that responsibility to a third party as well. But
back after the merger, there might not even be another company, right?
Well, no. The company would this was a stock deal or a membership interest deal, so the company would continue to exist post deal. So that's not really an issue. And, you know, what's interesting is that plaintiff's knee-jerk reaction in this case was that this transaction breached paragraph 3A. And they sued, bringing a breach of contract claim, saying you can't do this proposed transaction. It breaches paragraph 3A. Now, they later dropped that claim, stating to the district judge that that would have to go before Magistrate Judge Gelders. But there's no question that the parties understood that this type of agreement implicated paragraph 3A. And it couldn't simply be that, as the plaintiffs point out, that you could avoid this obligation by simply not including magic words in your agreement. We gave an example of an output contract where, let's say, Pacific Seafood agreed to acquire all of the output of Ocean Gold period. Under that circumstance, that agreement does not say, oh, and Pacific Seafood is going to sell all of that output. But that's the effect of the transaction. And when the parties defined this term and defined what new agreements would be governed by the 3A process, they did not define it by the form of the agreement. They defined it by the effect of the agreement.
Based on your, why do you think the plaintiffs are opposing the referral to arbitration if, in fact, you're saying, oh, they're the ones that wanted to not have to go through a multi-year litigation?
Well, you know, we can speculate, Your Honor. I don't know. I don't know why they're opposing this. They get a fair remedy in front of a named decision maker and a determination of, is this agreement pro-competitive or not? Can it be approved or not? That is the part, that's the process the parties agreed to.
We'll have to ask opposing counsel. Maybe he'll have a better answer.
Right. Well, you know, I think, you know, for example, you know, under the federal antitrust laws, there's the ability to get attorney's fees. There's a lot of other positives for a litigant. Whereas under this contract, it's a much simpler, easier process. And those options may not be available under that process. So I'd like to quickly turn to, if it's okay, and move to the preliminary injunction aspect of the appeal. But if you had any other questions about the contract, I could address those. We also ask that this court vacate what is an unnecessary preliminary injunction. And the Clayton Act is clear that to get a preliminary injunction or to order one, there must be a clear showing that the danger of irreparable loss or damage is immediate. That's the language of the statute. And what the district judge held here is that there was, that if this transaction were to occur, that it would substantially lessen competition. And we've pointed out that that was error too based on the record. But the order is completely silent on whether this transaction was immediate. And what the record was that it was not immediate, and that what Pacific Seafood was doing was walking through the agreed upon process. They provided notice of the transaction in December of 2014. They waited 5 to 6 weeks while plaintiff's counsel evaluated the transaction. They got word on January 21 that plaintiffs objected to the transaction. That same day, before a lawsuit was filed, Pacific Seafood contacted Ocean Gold, and this is in the record, at ER 225, and they notified Ocean Gold that the transaction is on hold until plaintiff's objections can be resolved. Counsel also submitted an email to now former judge Michael Hogan, attempting to tee this issue up. Then the lawsuit was filed, TRO entered, Pacific Seafood terminates the transaction. Pacific Seafood submits evidence to the district court that this transaction cannot be reconstituted in under 2 months and will even agree to give another 60 days notice if this transaction is put back online. And on that record, there simply is no basis for a court to enter the extraordinary heavy artillery relief of a preliminary injunction.
How are you hurt by the preliminary injunction if you're going to terminate this agreement? How are you hurt by this preliminary injunction if you've terminated this negotiation?
We've talked about the overbreadth of the preliminary injunction. For example, the preliminary injunction prohibits any further act to acquire. And our point on the overbreadth of the injunction is that the parties contemplated that Pacific Seafood and Ocean Gold would be having these type of preliminary negotiations, discussions, and trying to evaluate what kind of new agreement would replace the expiring joint venture agreement. So there's the overbreadth.
Are you not contending that because you've terminated the injunction, the entire case is moot?
Well, that issue was raised with the district court. That issue is not.
What is your contention now?
As to the mootness of?
Yes.
Well, you know, if this case goes to the appropriate decision maker, in our view, Magistrate Judge Gelders, I think we will submit that there's nothing here to be decided. I think that the issue of mootness will come up at a summary judgment motion. But there is no present intention to pursue this proposed transaction.
Suppose we decide hypothetically that this case is not covered by the arbitration provision. Under those circumstances, is it your contention that the case is or is not moot?
If it's not compelled to arbitration, I think that at the district court, one of many positions will be that there's nothing for the court to decide. The transaction is dead. But e- even that being said,
if they did, and there's no intention to resurrect it.
Well, that, you know, that's the record before the trial court on this appeal. The transaction is dead.
Okay.
We've also raised other issues. I'm happy to address any of those issues on the preliminary injunction.
But the main issues are on the preliminary injunction, one, the overbreath, and two, no immediate threat of...
No immediate threat. And you know,
right.
Those are the two issues. And I'll reserve the rest of my time for rebuttal. Thank you.
May it please the court, Michael Hagelin on behalf of the plaintiffs. The Lynch, I'll start with the motion to compel, which is the order that opposing counsel began with. As to the motion to compel, the absolute linchpin of Pacific Seafood Group's position is that section or paragraph 3A of the settlement agreement is an arbitration clause governed by the Federal Arbitration Act. 3A is not an arbitration clause. It does not include the word arbitration. Typically in an arbitration clause, you also see reference to the procedural rules that will govern that arbitration's procedures. No reference to any rules of any kind.
Do you take the position that if Judge Hogan or his substitute were to determine whether the agreement is pro-competitive or not, that determination would be subject to regular federal court appeal?
Yes, yes. We believe that Section 3A, paragraph 3A, simply provides for a referral of this issue to Judge Hogan or Magistrate Gelderks, provided the narrow issue covered there is what's at issue. That's not the case here. We filed a new action that does not, the amended complaint does not have any claim under the settlement agreement. It asserts claims under the Sherman Act, monopolization, attempted monopolization, and then under the Clayton Act for unlawful merger.
If that's true, as opposed to, you know, being an arbitration provision, which I think itself has problems, but if that's true, then it really raises a problem. Judge Bayer referred to it. It's just the parties picking their own judge, isn't it? I think that's frowned upon in the federal system.
I think it is, Your Honor, and I was the lead lawyer in the underlying case, the Whaley case. I was intimately involved in all those negotiations that led to this resolution agreement, and frankly, I think the way it's crafted is likely beyond the ancillary, or absolutely beyond the ancillary jurisdiction of the court.
Do you have any authority to cite to support that statement?
Yes. If you look at the cases we've cited on ancillary jurisdiction, here the defendants just dismiss our cases as effectively overruled by the ADR Act of 1998. However, if one looks at that statute for the contention that they urge, which is that magistrates can serve as arbitrators, you find in the actual language of the Section 636B3 that magistrates are authorized to be assigned such additional duties as are not inconsistent with the Constitution and laws of the U.S. There's no reference to magistrates serving as arbitrators. There is a reference in Section 653 to magistrates serving as neutrals in connection with mediations. There's also reference to magistrates being able to preside or be able to coordinate our alternative dispute resolution processes. But as the Delaware Coalition case out of Delaware, a district court decision in 2012, 4 years after that statute was passed, that's a very instructive case. In that case, the district court found that despite, and that was a case, it's interesting, the particular facts of that case, that was a case where the Chancery Court in Delaware adopted, the legislature, and in turn the court, adopted a rule providing that the Chancery Court judges could sit as arbitrators in business cases where the parties consented. And there was a further provision that those arbitrations, like private arbitration generally, are closed confidential proceedings. And the Delaware Coalition for Open Government challenged the constitutionality of that procedure. The district court ultimately concluded that although it was labeled arbitration, because it was a sitting chancery court judge acting as the so-called arbitrator, that it was essentially a civil trial, which is what I contend is the thrust of what 3A would do were we covered by 3A before Judge Hogan. It would be a civil trial in front of Judge Hogan over whether or not a renewal of the exclusive marketing agreement was pro-competitive or not.
Your position is that provision is unenforceable. The parties can't pick their federal judge.
Yes. And in the coalition case, the district court ultimately decided in favor of the plaintiffs and held that the confidential provision, confidentiality, secret arbitration proceeding before a sitting chancery court judge violated the First Amendment and was unconstitutional. And he quoted with authority Judge Posner's opinion out of the Seventh Circuit in the DDI seamless cylinder case, which held squarely that judicial officers, whether they are federal judges or magistrate judges, have no authority to act as both an arbitrator and a judge. As Judge Posner put it, a federal magistrate cannot on one day arbitrate a case as a private arbitrator and on the next day confirm his award. Citation there to significant commentary over the problems with the notion that a judicial officer, like a federal judge or a magistrate, can serve as an arbitrator.
Okay, I understand your argument on that. Let's pass that and get to, you know, the subject of the arbitration proceeding as set forth in the agreement, right? Now, Mr. Snyder construes that subject, you know, I think fairly broadly, but it's not, it is plausible, isn't it? Is construction of the what's covered by that agreement?
No, it's not. If you conclude, as I think you should, that the Federal Arbitration Act doesn't apply, and as soon as that goes by the boards, all of the case law they cite about how any language that suggests the parties are referring a dispute to a
third party. Why doesn't the Federal Arbitration Act apply?
Because the magistrates and federal judges cannot serve as arbitrators.
Just say so. Pass by that point.
Well,
and get to the subject of the proposed arbitration. Isn't the defendant's reading of that subject plausible?
No, it's not, because if you look at the four corners of the settlement agreement, paragraph 24 is the actual operative one entitled jurisdiction of the court. It's the court that has the jurisdiction, not a private mediator. And it's abundantly clear in the defendant's papers that they believe what is required here is a private arbitration. On page 15 of their reply brief, they say that it is a dispute resolution to be performed, quote, by a named individual, not the court. On page 17, they say Section 3A is enforced, quote, by compelling the process, not by having the district court perform the process itself. It can't be done in this fashion in a federal court. You also run afoul of the ancillary jurisdiction cases that we cite. Peacock, out of the U.S. Supreme Court, makes it clear that when you have a settlement agreement like this one, over which the federal court is to retain jurisdiction to interpret and enforce it, you cannot then have the federal court involved in a proceeding that is more expansive than what was factually interdependent on the underlying case. Here, the relief we seek in this case, which they now seek to move into an arbitration context, is beyond the ancillary jurisdiction because it involves new claims, no Clayton Act claim in the underlying case. It involves a significant number of brand new parties. And the Ninth Circuit case law is clear that in those sorts of circumstances, when you interpret Peacock and the ancillary jurisdiction of this court correctly, you cannot extend ancillary jurisdiction to something that was beyond the core.
But you were involved in negotiating this resolution agreement. Is that what you're telling us?
I was,
and now you concede or confess that you negotiated an unenforceable agreement.
Well, as to one paragraph, I never imagined, Your Honor, and we make this point clear, they seek, using the FAA as the springboard, to breathe incredibly expansive life into paragraph 3A. I took 3A at the end of the day when we signed this agreement for what it stands for. If you're going to renew the exclusive marketing agreement, then 3A is in play.
But you're now saying that really wouldn't work because you can't do it.
I never was aware of the case law that related to the limited powers that federal judges.
You've learned something in the intervening years.
We have. But the other thing that I never imagined, because the issue of whether Pacific Seafood would acquire Ocean Gold came up very early in the underlying case. We quickly got a TRO against that, and they then said, deal is off, and they entered into a stipulation. We never even amended our complaint to assert a claim to prevent Pacific Seafood Group from ever acquiring Ocean Gold because it was resolved by a stipulation so early. The idea that somehow we've released a claim related to facts, economic circumstances in 2015 on behalf of a class action of West Coast fishermen just doesn't stand up when you look at the facts and circumstances and procedural history of this case.
Is this case currently set for trial next February?
It was, but following the decision by the Ninth Circuit to consolidate these appeals, a motion for stay was granted, so the case schedule was suspended pending your decision in these cases.
We're not under pressure to give an instant resolution. We'll try to do it promptly.
That'd be appreciated.
Trial, if we don't agree to refer it to arbitration or whatever, I gather there'll be a new trial date set by the district.
Yes.
What about Mr. Snyder's point that the preliminary injunction was totally unnecessary because even before it was issued, they had agreed to put the acquisition on hold, and then shortly after that, they terminated the.
Let me respond to that, Your Honor. In fact, this case was filed because on the day before it was filed, we asked for confirmation that there was no imminent closing, and we did not get that confirmation from opposing counsel, and that's in the record. We then filed and got the preliminary, got the TRO, and it eventually got the preliminary injunction. They asserted at the preliminary injunction stage that it was moot. And Judge Panner, in his decision granting the preliminary injunction, relied on a body of mootness case law in this circuit as well as elsewhere, that where you have a voluntary secession of an action, that does not moot the case unless it's absolutely clear that the action can't be continued in some fashion. And he found squarely that it was not moot. And I think it's very significant, turning to the PI or preliminary injunction issues, to look at what this contract really is. The characterization of it as a joint venture is just far off the mark. This contract provides that Pacific Seafood Group ultimately buys, they pay Ocean Gold a contract rate for processing the various seafood products that the company makes. Pacific Seafood receives a 5% commission, and that after a number of cost allocations to cover borrowing costs, et cetera, there is a division of profits according to the contract. But in no way, shape, or form are they, as they contend in their brief, a combined operation operating like the Blue Cross Blue Shield one company case from the Seventh Circuit, because at the ex-vessel point where the processors are buying fish from the client group I represented and the current client group as well, they are independent, and provisions in this the exclusive marketing agreement were stricken to ensure that that independence was maintained. In other words, when it comes to what do they pay for the shrimp that fishermen have to sell, or whiting or ground fish, they absolutely must act independently. And provisions in this agreement, if you look at paragraph 3B, which were provisions in this contract that would suggest strongly that Pacific Seafood Group had the power to tell Ocean Gold what to pay fishermen, flat-out price fixing, which in depositions they contended, oh, we never did any of this. They agreed, as in paragraph 3B of the settlement agreement, that those provisions would be stricken. And in fact, Ocean Gold, after the settlement agreement was signed, this is in the record through our expert fisheries economist, for the first time entered the shrimp market, buying shrimp independently. They purchased the peelers, the expensive equipment that's necessary to process these small shrimp, and entered that market as an independent player. In terms of the viability of, or the properness of Judge Panner's decision in connection with granting the motion for preliminary injunction, I think there's no better evidence that it was appropriate than Hans Radke, our fisheries economist's declaration, which shows that, you know, extraordinarily high market shares, consistent with the, in an unlawful merger case, if your statistical evidence shows high market shares, you're virtually entitled to an injunction. And here we had not just the plaintiffs from the prior case, their counsel advocating for this, but the State of Oregon's Attorney General filed an amicus brief in this case strongly urging Judge Panner to issue this injunction and noting that the very substantial market shares made this merger, and I quote, presumptively unlawful, unquote. And the state then went through all of the different criteria showing that a preliminary injunction was clearly warranted. And the idea that, if you look at the defendant's arguments, they defend primarily on the notion that we released these claims. That's one of their biggest arguments, is that we released the claims for injunctive relief. But look at the settlement agreement and look at the release clause, which is paragraph 2. It says, it defines the release claims as any and all claims for monopolization, attempted monopolization, or conspiracy to restrain trade under the Sherman Act that relate to the delivery of these three categories of fish between a defined 5.5-year period from mid-2006 through 2011. And specifically including any claims for damages and or injunctive relief related to those claims. They contend that our reference to releasing injunctive relief claims that relate to a 5.5-year period preclude us from making the claims that we make in a lawsuit filed in 2015 after Ocean Gold has been in a new market for 2 years. And after market conditions have changed in other ways that will be developed in discovery. That is an absolutely make-weight argument on their, in terms of the breadth of that sort of release. This is not like the case they cite where you have the personal injury type of release where it goes back to the beginning of time and it covers all claims of every nature whatsoever, known or unknown, past, present, or future. That's not the clause we signed.
Thank you, Your Honors. So basically, the plaintiff's argument is that Judge Hogan and the parties negotiated a legal agreement that was then approved by Judge Panner, that these judges did not know that parties cannot choose their federal judge acting as judge and entered into an illegal agreement. That's an extraordinary argument, and it's contrary to what this court is supposed to do in interpreting an agreement. When you interpret an agreement, you're supposed to avoid an interpretation that would result in an illegality.
Have you got any case you can cite us that says this agreement is, in fact, okay?
Well, if it's an arbitration agreement, I think it is okay. If it's a ancillary jurisdiction clause selecting your judge, it is not okay. We don't have
which is it then? Is there any case that would, in a similar fact situation, tell us?
Well, we know that there's no per se rule against federal judges acting as arbitrators. If, like this case, a federal judge, Panner, appoints a judge to act in that neutral role, as is done in the party's resolution agreement.
I thought Judge Postman said you can't be an arbitrator on Monday and a judge on Tuesday approving your actions as an arbitrator on Monday.
Well, and that's not what's happening here. The same judge is not approved, not wearing the arbitrator hat and then putting on his affirming district court hat. This is a named decision makers, and presumably this arbitration award.
If it's an arbitration award, as Judge Hogan, let's say he was still around, as arbitrator, and the claim was that he exceeded his jurisdiction, who would determine that?
Well, it would be the district court.
And who? Wouldn't it be Judge Hogan as the district court?
Well, Judge Hogan was not the district court in the Whaley lawsuit. The current district judge is Judge McShane. Judge McShane would review the award of the magistrate Judge Gelders, and that would be the process here. So it's not the same judge, and it's not the problem that Judge Posner had. Moreover, Judge Posner's opinion is from 1994, and what happened in 1998 is this ADR Act, where Congress said, we don't have a problem with magistrate judges serving as neutrals, and neutral includes one of the ADR processes furthered by that act is arbitration. And you construe the act as written, magistrate judges are permitted to serve as neutrals and preside over court-ordered arbitrations under that act. So there is no rule against federal judges in this unique context in which we're in, where the parties enter into a court-approved settlement agreement that provides that certain disputes will be resolved this way. It's not that the parties on their own entered into an agreement in private and commandeered a federal judge to be their arbitrator. That's not the case here. And to interpret this agreement otherwise would be to interpret it in a way that's unenforceable and illegal. And that just cannot be what the parties were intending.
Sounds like we've got a case of first impression on this issue, though.
It is a unique process. But we cited this court to a 1952 U.S. Supreme Court case, Besser Manufacturing versus United States. And in that case, the U.S. Supreme Court is 343 U.S. 444. That's the site. The Supreme Court affirmed a district judge who acted as a fifth arbitrator in a royalty fee dispute under antitrust laws. Both parties selected two arbitrators. They were deadlocked. The district court appointed himself as the fifth and deciding arbitrator. And the court said, while this was an innovation, novelty is not synonymous with error, and affirmed the district court's broad authority in an antitrust case to set up this dispute resolution process. So there is no per se rule that says this can't be what the parties intended it to be, to provide that Judge Hogan or his replacement, Magistrate Judge Gelders, will make this decision on this issue of these types of agreements.
What's the name of that case?
It's Besser Manufacturing versus United States, 343 U.S. 444. We also cited a Ninth Circuit case from 1925, Gox
Hofstetter. That's 9 F. 2nd 354, in which the Ninth Circuit affirmed a district court acting as arbitrator to value assets of an insolvent bank.
You keep going back in time. Can you cite Marbury versus Madison?
We did not find that. Although, lastly, the Code of Conduct for U.S. Judges we did cite. And that Canon 4A4 prohibits federal judges from serving as an arbitrator apart from the judge's official duties. That clearly recognizes that in some circumstance, a federal judge may be called upon to serve as an arbitrator within the scope of his or her official duties. So there is no per se prohibition. I think I'm out of time.
Thank you very much. Thanks, counsel, for a very good argument. And that being the last case on our calendar, court will adjourn until 9 o'clock tomorrow morning.